I love the low, lazy burble of a Rover V8, but that's the thing, it is a bit of a lazy burble. This engine has so much potential waiting to be eked out. After all, it is the very same V8 that you see in all kinds of motorsport settings, from hill climbs to drag races. So to get a bit more power out of this engine, we're going to have to go deep inside it.
The plan is to change the camshaft, the part which spins deep inside the engine and forces the valves open and shut, controlling the flow of the fuel air mixture in and the exhaust out of the engine. By fitting a high lift cam, I can change the way those valves are opened and shut and improve the engine performance. A standard V8 would pump out around 170 horsepower. We could get up to 190 horsepower with the new cam.
One of the parts I'm going to be taking off the engine is the distributor, and it's critical that I get it back in the right position in relation to the rotation of the crankshaft, otherwise the engine won't run properly. So what I'm going to do first of all, just setting the crank to top dead centre, and then what I can do is take off the distributor cap and then use a bit of correction fluid to mark where the rotor arm is pointing, and that way when I take it out, put it back in again, I can get it perfectly aligned.
Setting the crank at top dead centre and then marking the position of the rotor arm in the distributor will ensure that the ignition timing is set properly. This sets the exact moment when the spark will occur during each cylinder's compression or combustion stroke, which in turn affects everything from fuel economy to engine performance and longevity. It's vital stuff.
With the carburetor and manifold out of the way and with the valley gasket removed, I can finally see what all this has been about. Down in the depths there of the valley, in the middle of the V, you've got a camshaft. Now that is what I want to change, and it's a very important part of the engine. Now if you look down here, you can see these kind of lumps on this metal stick, if you like. Those are the lobes. Those lobes push on the cam followers, which in turn push on the push rods. They then push on the rocker arms, and they in turn push on the valves, opening and closing them at exactly the right time. Now to tell you any more, I need to get that camshaft out.
This is a V8 with two valves per cylinder, so of course there are 16 push rods, 8 on each bank of the engine. I'm carefully placing them in this piece of cardboard so I remember where to locate them when I rebuild the engine. Then I'm gently removing the hydraulic valve lifters to stop them fouling on the camshaft when it's drawn out.
Oh, well, there we go. This is our cast iron camshaft. Now, obviously, we're doing this because we're going to try and increase the performance of our engine, but actually, we're going to get a bit more power than we first thought, because if you look at some of these lobes, you can see they're actually a little bit worn, and in fact, there's a bit of pitting on some of them as well, which means they're being worn down, and that means you're not going to get as much lift or duration on the valves. Of course, means you're going to be losing a bit of power, so it's doubly good that we're going to be doing our conversion.
I picked up a new high-lift camshaft on the internet for just £127. On the bench, you can clearly see the difference in the metal lobes. The new one has more defined peaks. The lobes on the old one look rounder and smoother. These peaks are what gives the high-lift I keep talking about. That's where the better performance comes from.
Our brand new cam, our Viper Hurricane, which already sounds much more exciting and powerful, is actually designed very much for this job. It's got perhaps 20 brake horsepower more than a standard cam, but the main thing is the power is right where you need it, in that bottom end grunt.
As you've probably worked out, this really is a full-on job. You could tackle it at home, but I would suggest you leave yourself plenty of time, because I've got 50% of the engine parts on the bench. If you can manage it though, it would save you around £400 in labour from an off-road specialist.
Now, this is a great top tip when you're reassembling engine parts just like this. As I'm putting the camshaft into the engine, I'm actually smearing all of those surfaces with like an engine braking additive. Basically, it's like a real super gloopy kind of oil, and that way it coats all of those metal bearing surfaces, and that way, when of course you spin the car up for the first time, it's not just graunched loads of fresh metal together, it's actually going to slip around nicely and bed in and brake in just the way it should do. At last, everything is done. So now I get to turn the key, and if I've done everything right, when I do turn that key, it's going to fire into life. And if it does, I need to keep it running for about half an hour and vary the revs between, say, 1500 and 2500 RPM. And that way, it's going to help bed the cam in. Let's just hope Mike appreciates that boost in power. This has been one big oily job. Hey! Oh, that sounds pretty sweet. So now I'm just gonna sit here
To let the light into our Land Rover, I'm going to fit some big windows in the rear. But before I can cut some holes, I've got to remove these internal strengthening uprights. They're held in place with rivets that I'm drilling out with a high-speed steel bit.
With the reinforcement out of the way, I can now concentrate on trying to mark out the panel. Now, the idea is, I'm actually going to do most of my work from the outside of the vehicles, it would be a lot easier, but what I want to make sure is I've actually got my centres on this side correct. I'm just going to use a bit of masking tape to mark out where that's going to go. I'll drill a hole through and then I'll do the rest of the marking out from the other side of the vehicle.
This masking tape is roughly where the hole for the window will go. The rear window is usually equidistant between the front and back of the rear cab, so now I'm measuring and marking my centre point. I've already measured up the windows I'm fitting, and now I'm transferring those measurements to the masking tape to mark the edges of the hole for the window.
So now what I need to do, I'm going to use a really tiny drill bit that's actually going to drill through the centre and perhaps even through these two markings here, and then I can measure from the other side and make sure everything's going to be just so.
OK, now I've got my drill marks established, I'm drawing up an external template using masking tape once again.
So now I've got the masking tape in position, I'm just using a pen to find those holes I drilled before. And I'm just going to use a nice big straight edge to draw on exactly where I want our datum. And the reason I'm using masking tape is, of course, then if I was to get it slightly wrong, I can always rip it off and start again.
Now, I have cut holes in bodywork before and I've not yet made a big mistake. I'm anxious to keep that record intact. Always measure twice and cut just the once. The observant among you probably realise that the windows have rounded edges, so I found something with the same radius, a roll of masking tape, and I'll just use that as a template on each side of the defender. Might as well keep it simple.
Now, for these corners, which I'm going to cut first, I'm actually going to be using a jigsaw. Before I can use the jigsaw, I need to make sure I can get the blade in. So I'm just going to drill a hole at the beginning of each of those cuts. And bear in mind, of course, because of this kind of lumpy edge here, what I need to do is go that way with the cut rather than trying to go around and hit that. So it just means I can just make a nice little easy start. It doesn't have to be too close to the line.
It's jigsaw time. No going back after this. We're off. After I've done the corners, I change to a 1mm cutting disc to create nice straight lines.
Okay, well now I have a hole. The next thing I need to do is just clean these edges because they're nice and sharp. So I just got this very clever little tool.
This tool deburrs the edges. That's removing lots of sharp and nasty swarf, which the cutting blades left behind.
Right, well, with everything deburred, it's probably quite a good time just to see if I've actually cut the right size hole or offer up the new window. So I'm happy I've got the window in place, and now what I'm doing, I'm using a slightly oversized drill bit to the rivets I actually need. I'm just using that, these holes are already here, just to give me a centre, so just get a little bit of a mark. And just saves marking them all out.
The window sits on its bead of silicone. Once I'm happy the window is aligned correctly, I insert a few rivets to hold it in position. Three jaws inside the head of the pop rivet tool are closed around the rivet's shaft and drawn back as the handles are squeezed together. The steel shaft is attached to the tip of the rivet and so crushes the rest of the softer aluminium outer part towards the rivet's flange, thereby clamping the window to the bodywork. The steel shaft is stretched until it breaks at a pre-weakened point inside the head of the rivet, which leaves a strong but neat mechanical fixing.
Well, now the window's riveted in, it is looking nearly factory, and to that end, if you notice here, the catch is at the top of the window, just like the more modern vehicles, so we're getting on that way to this 20 years younger look.
Click here to subscribe.